I want to ask, have you ever had one of those moments when maybe someone made a comment to you, and before your brain could really even engage fully and think it through, you found yourself just uncorking? I mean, just letting the person have it. Maybe it wasn't even them, maybe other people had, and it just, you just had had enough, and you just found yourself barking back some harsh reply and maybe dredging up things from the past like arrows from a quiver. And after you let off a couple volleys, you know, only then did it really come to you, and you really realize that you may have misunderstood what they said, and really they didn't make a harsh comment, you just took it the wrong way or something like that. I don't know. Now, I've only read about that happening, but I imagine that does happen. You get the point. And I'm guessing for some of us, if we work really hard, we can dredge up one or two examples in our own lives where we've kind of slipped into foot-in-mouth syndrome. But for some of the others of us, that might be a daily occurrence. That might be just kind of our thing to bear, and we find ourselves into that a lot. And I'm always grateful that some of the great Bible characters that the Lord teaches us so much about, Peter, a lot of times, had that same syndrome, and sometimes he would jump out of there before he'd really thought it all through. Well, the truth is whether it's a rare happening or a daily occurrence for you, this is the exact issue that Jesus' brother James had in mind in his letter to the churches. That statement, which is now conveniently bound for us in the book of James, chapter 1, verse 19 in our New Testament, is still a great life lesson, and it simply says we must be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. We've mentioned that passage before, but that is a truth that we need to just start with this morning. We must be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Now, if you've been around here for a while, you know that we've been journeying through, as I just mentioned, this book of Proverbs and just gaining the wisdom that it has to give us. For those that might be new, Proverbs is a compilation of the wisest writings put together by the wisest man to ever live. And the book of Proverbs is King Solomon's gathering of his wisdom as well as wisdom of others, and it's left for us to take and use and to apply into our lives the best we can. So we're going to dive into that this morning. So you may ask, why are we starting with a passage out of the New Testament if we're supposed to be talking about wisdom literature that was written 700 years before Jesus was even born in Bethlehem? Well, the reason is because we are tackling a rather large section of Proverbs this morning, 8 chapters, verse 12 through 19. So we'll be here till 4 o'clock this afternoon. No, we're not. But in this great section, there is a ton that is covered in this. There is a ton of really, really good information, really good Proverbs, really good wisdom that's put out there. But if I were to boil all of those 8 chapters down and the themes that kind of occur again and again and again, we would, for Proverbs 12 through 19, come up with the one concise truth that, yes, we must be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. But obviously, if you have ever wrestled around that, and maybe you're aware of that James passage, maybe you're aware of that truth, and you have found that that is one of those things that is much easier said than done. And sometimes we come across passages in Scripture that are like, wow, that is really good stuff. And we find ourselves trying again and again and failing again and again to actually put it into practice. Well, what I love about the way that the Lord works is so many times, and sometimes we have to dig around for it a little bit, is he doesn't just throw something like that out there and say good luck with it, but gives us some keys, some ways to go about doing this. And these chapters 12 through 19, as much as there's a ton in there, there is a few very specific proverbs that speak to the way that we might go about carrying out that practice of being quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. And so we're just going to bounce around a few of these. And I do understand, I will acknowledge right now, I will do a great disservice to these 8 proverbs, 8 chapters of Proverbs, but we're just centraling in on these few topics, and so we're going to dive through this. It's, if you ask the question, how can I really go about being quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, the first clue is found in Proverbs chapter 12, and it is basically the truth that we must stay calm in the face of insults. All right, so like we've got to decide ahead of time to put into practice this idea that no matter what comes my way, I will stay calm in the midst of it. And it's what's being talked about in chapter 12, verse 16, where he simply says, a fool is quick-tempered, but a wise person stays calm when insulted. And again, that's one of those things like, well, that sounds great, but just to be aware of that, to be aware that this is one of the things that the Lord wants to help us to do, to not be quick-tempered, but to be calm in the face of insult. So absolutely necessary to the art of this practice of being quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry is the ability to do that. One author talking about this writes, "A fool's reaction when insulted, whether justly or unjustly, is like that of an injured or a frightened animal." So you've seen, we've all seen this. We've seen that even the most docile animals, if they're backed up into a corner or they're frightened or they're scared, they will lash out. Our daughter loved cats. She loved kittens growing up. We never had a cat because we learned very quickly she did not have the ability to pick up the clues that cats give you when they're done with you. And she would come back from friends' houses just scratched up to pieces because, you know, she'd do that. I would love you and hug you and squeeze you and not pick up when they were done with that. But one of the best examples of this picture, this mindset of this, and it comes from my sister and brother-in-law. My sister Chelsea and her husband Johnny, they pastor a church in Northern California. They are the two biggest animal lovers I've ever met in my life. I mean, at any given time, there are 4, 5, 6 injured or stray animals at their house that they've found on the side of the road or nursing back to life or whatever it might be. They're always, always taking care of animals. And not too long ago in our hometown in Northern California, they developed a skunk problem. Now, they were renting a house and some property, and so they'd reached out to the owners and told them, hey, you know, skunks are coming around every night, and it's kind of, if you've ever dealt with this, he said, no problem, I will take care of it. And then suddenly one day, a few traps showed up around the property, and one morning, Johnny was heading out to work, and he looked and he saw, sure enough, that they had caught a skunk in one of the traps, and knowing enough to keep his distance, he went off to work. And he said, all morning at work, he started to think about what was the owner going to do with that skunk. And he knew it had something to do with the .22 bullet and all this. And it started to really bother him. And he started to be very concerned about this poor skunk. So he goes home at lunch and he decides that he's going to relocate this skunk before it could do any harm. So he read up a little bit. He throws a blanket over the cage, takes him to the field behind his house because apparently the skunk wouldn't come out, whatever. Anyway, he takes him away and decides he's going to let this skunk go. And of course, the skunk will understand that he just saved his life and not come back and bother his property and be very grateful. And so he covers a little bit, opens up the cage. The skunk steps out about 3 steps and does what skunks do, lets him have it for all of the inconvenience that he'd had. And he's just doused. And I saw him later that day from a distance. And for days, he was just a mess because of this. But that picture is exactly the mental picture that we're talking about that I, you know, really center around when I think about this. A perfect illustration for how we, more often than not, react when we receive a perceived insult. So whatever's going on in our life, when someone insults us, we are suddenly like that caged animal, that skunk or whatever, and we just uncork. We just let them have it because how dare you? And it goes. And I say perceived because many times it really wasn't even an intentional comment. Or maybe, you know, somebody else has said some things and we're now on edge about something, but it wasn't really meant. But case in point, in his story, the skunk sprayed the wrong person. He was just trying to help the skunk. A biblically wise person has learned that when perceived insults come our way, the best reaction is to stay as calm as possible. That's really the driving force of this proverb. And as many of you know, many times this is simply very, very difficult, nearly impossible by human standards. That's why I love the fact that God is near and he wants to be our strength or our calm when we are trying not to react poorly. Psalm 46, it's not up here, but it simply says in verse 6, the nations are in chaos and their kingdoms crumble. And then verse 10, be still and know that I am God. You know, that is one of those so important things when we want to react, when we find ourselves just so under it and feeling like we have to let it go, to be reminded that's true for nations, that's true for other things, that's true for people. Things are chaos, but be still and know that I am God. I have you. I have this situation under control, and we don't necessarily have to react. But being calm in the midst of insult is, again, it's easier said than done, and sometimes it'll only be possible in meditating on the truth that he is there with us regardless of what else is going on. So we must stay calm in the face of insult. Second key to putting this into practice is that we must think carefully before responding. Proverbs 15:28 says, "The heart of the godly thinks carefully before speaking. The mouth of the wicked overflows with evil words." It's almost as if the first point is stay calm. Just stay calm enough to give ourselves a moment to evaluate whether the perceived insult was even really an insult to start with, okay? So that's the stay calm part. The second part, point two, is how to respond when the insult is real, and it does require some kind of response, because there is times where something is said and it does require a response from us, and that's where it is driving us. Please stay calm and think carefully before we respond. I love it that the text that talks about this, it's just basically saying think carefully about this, because it literally, it says that the mind of the righteous weighs, and the word is yege, and it means the mind of the righteous considers or muses or meditates or studies how to answer. You get this picture of like really concentrating on what is the best way. So the proverbial advice here is really to say less but better things. Like to be able to stay calm enough to not have to say a ton, but just to say the right thing. And again, this is where James' words are such a great synopsis of these Proverbs chapters. It's the idea of being slow to speak, slow to speak and slow to become angry. Golden State Junior High was a failed experiment, okay? I went to middle school, Golden State Junior High, and some board somewhere had decided that they were gonna make a junior high that was 7th, 8th, and 9th graders. Now, you may know most middle schools are 6, 7, 8, or just 7, 8. There is something about the combination of 7th, 8th, and 9th graders that was most horrible, well, specifically for me, because I was a 7th grader. And I at that time, 9th graders looked like these huge adults with facial hair and everything. I know now I look at a 9th grader, I think that's pretty young. But then they just seemed like these ginormous human beings that had no patience for us 7th graders. And so my entire existence at Golden State Junior High was trying to keep my head low and keep out of anybody's attention and never ever draw attention. So there I am standing mid-court talking to a couple friends. When I happened to notice a group of us who was near us started to take these long, like half-court shots in the gym, and they were missing by a mile, and because really our PE at that time was not PE at all. We would just get thrown into the gym, like 100 of us, 7th, 8th, and 9th graders. The coaches would go stand in a circle and talk, and then we would fend for ourselves. So I watched these guys taking these huge shots, and this guy takes this huge shot, misses by a mile, the ball takes two bounces, and it hits the biggest, meanest, scariest 9th grader at our school in the back of the head. And I remember having a few thoughts at that exact moment. One thought was, I wonder what kind of memorial service we should throw for this kid, because I knew he was just about to die. I mean, it was just this terrible situation. And as I'm thinking about this and thinking about how bad this is, and my second thought was how glad I was it wasn't me, I see this kid go over to those PE teachers, and he's very upset, and I see him, and I'm thinking, he's asking them who threw the ball. And to my horror, I see one of the PE teachers turn around and point out the kid, and I'm thinking, truly, this is a dead man. And at the moment that I'm coming to grips with the irresponsibleness of this teacher that would do this thing and call out a kid, I realize a second horrible thing. He was pointing out the wrong kid, because he wasn't pointing at the kid who threw the basketball, he was pointing at me. So fast forward, I'm on the ground trying to come to, all right, because this kid came and just, I don't know how many times he punched me, but I was down on the ground. And as I'm coming on my feet, coming to grips with what just happened, the fact that all this, I lose it. I finally, all of my pent-up frustration of a semester's worth of just getting whatever thing just comes, and I make a beeline for this PE teacher. And like made for a movie script, I let him have it. I mean, I explained to him how irresponsible he is, and I'm sure it didn't make quite the sense of it, but I'm screaming at the top of my lungs. I'm like, how dare you? Not only did you point out someone when you shouldn't have, but you pointed out the wrong person. And, you know, and I got hit because of you, and you don't even care. Blah. And by the end, I'm screaming. And finally, he just looks at me, and he goes, first of all, you're nuts, okay? I don't even know what you're talking about, but you need to calm down, kid. I just walked out here. And as he's explaining this, I realized, I finally looked at his face. It wasn't even the right PE teacher. It wasn't the guy that actually pointed me out, and I couldn't even find that guy all of a sudden. And by then, I spent my fire. I was all done, and I just walked out of the gym. It's just a horrible moment that really captures this idea of when we just, sometimes we feel like, boy, we're just ready to go at it, and we just go at it, but we didn't really think the whole thing through and never really even thought, who was it that actually had pointed me out? I just wanted to go lay it on somebody. That whole scenario in there needed a lot of James 1:19. Everybody in that story was really needed to know that we should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. All of that is to say that we need to keep in our mind the man who is gifted as the wisest man ever looks us in the eye and says, look, whether the insult is right, is wrong, is indifferent, just do yourself a favor. Stop for just a second and think carefully before you respond. And how much trouble will that save us in the way we go about things? Third thing, which is key, is that we then must overlook wrongs and give up our rights. 19:1, Proverbs 19:1 says, sensible people control their temper. They earn respect by overlooking wrongs. So if point one is to determine if the insult is really even truly an insult, or maybe it's just developing the art of pretending that we weren't insulted in living life, and if point two is to carefully determine what to say in response to a true insult, then this third point is about when the insult is real and we do have a right to defend ourselves, but maybe it's not the time, or we need to just simply overlook the wrong. The willingness to just overlook when we truly have been insulted, it was perceived correctly, but we just need to overlook it. Meaning, in the situation where we are justified to attack back and to defend our honor, that whereas I do have the right to do this, how about giving up that right and simply overlooking the wrong? One commentary writes this. It says, the virtue which is indicated here is more than a forgiving temper. It includes also the ability to shrug off insults and the absence of a brooding hypersensitivity. I think that phrase right there is so needed in our society today, but the absence of a brooding hypersensitivity. It's the ability to deny an adversary the pleasure of hearing a yelp of pain, even when his words have inflicted a wound, of making large allowances for human frailties and keeping the lines of communication open. It contains elements of toughness and self-discipline. And the act of literally being able to do this, even though I have the right to impose my will in this situation, are there times where God says, I would rather you not? And I cannot think of a better example of that than Appomattox Courthouse, April 1865. You know that story, you know that the Confederate Army led by Ulysses S. Grant had arrived at Appomattox Courthouse to surrender unconditionally to Ulysses S. Grant Robert E. Lee and the Confederate Army to surrender unconditionally to Ulysses S. Grant and the Union Army. And the term unconditional surrender meant that Grant had the right to impose whatever he wanted on the Confederate Army on that battlefield. That their unconditional surrender, they had no rights, there was no parley, there was no ability to ask for anything. But in that moment, an incredible act of grace happened, because as they came and surrendered and as Grant and Lee met, Grant made the unheard of decision at that moment that he was going to allow all the Confederates that were heading home from that battlefield to keep their weapons, and just with the honor that they wouldn't be using them, which is just mind-boggling. And then he went one step further and he sent word down the line that every Union soldier that was there was to take his rations, cut them in half, find a Confederate soldier, and give them to that Confederate soldier. Okay, the Union Army had won. They'd been in horrible, inflicted pain, this battle that was just devastating to our nation. There was finally victory, and they had the right to impose whatever they wanted on that group, on that Confederate Army, and instead chose to start the process of rebuilding at that very moment by showing this incredible act of grace. That is the mindset that is going into this. I've shared before about a pastor friend of mine who has modeled this balance so well when he tries to ask that question whenever dealing with someone in this way. Is my action redemptive or is it punitive? Is what I'm about to do meant to redeem the situation, redeem the person, or is it just simply designed to punish them because I have a right to punish them? And we need to keep that in mind. All of these three points that we talked about are definitely easier said than done, and they're all nearly impossible at times on our own human standards. And that's why this fourth point is so key to being able to truly be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, and that's that we must keep our hearts open to the Holy Spirit. If we're going to have any success at this, we need to be about the business of letting the Holy Spirit be in our business. But we must constantly be laying our heart bare before the Lord and allowing Him. Now, chapter 17, verse 3 might not sound like it's speaking to this, but when it says, "Fire tests the purity of silver and gold, but the Lord tests the heart." And the idea in this is that obviously, no matter how pure a nugget of gold is, before it is made into jewelry or put into purpose for whatever it is, it goes through a fire. It goes through so that it is completely melted. And whenever that happens, whatever impurities are in there, they will float to the top and be scraped off so that it is just the pure gold or the pure silver. And this mindset, this idea that just as impurities will come to the surface of gold and silver when they're met with heat, so too will impurities in our own heart surface when we're met with situational heat. And we have to be about letting the Holy Spirit do a work on us and continually cleanse that stuff off, because if that heart isn't being cleansed of all the impurities, we're gonna have such a difficult time reacting in this biblical way, because those impurities will always win the day. And so long before we get the confrontational meeting, long before someone says the horrible thing, long before we're processing all this, we have to be letting the Holy Spirit do a work on our hearts so that we can react in the way that He is most desiring to. 1 Corinthians 6:19 says, "Don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and was given to you by God?" We believe very much the biblical truth of this principle. The Holy Spirit wants to take up residence in our heart. And I get asked that all the time, like, well, why do we say, like, invite Jesus into my heart? That seems like kind of a weird statement. It's because of this idea that the picture that is drawn for us is that the Holy Spirit wants to come and live in our lives. I'd read an article a while back that challenges us to consider our heart, if that's true, if the Holy Spirit comes and lives here, to really think about our heart as a home. And as such, like, to really identify the different rooms in that home where we are inviting the Holy Spirit to come and take up residence. Then inside this heart, there is like a study or a library, and this is our mind, this is our thought life. Think about the fact that we're inviting the Holy Spirit to come into our mind and our thought life, and have we cleaned out that room? Is that room truly prepared? That there's a dining room, and this is where our desires lay, the things that we want out of life. Have we invited Him into that room? That we have a living room or a family room in our heart, and this is our friends and the nature of those friendships. Have we let the Holy Spirit into that room? Or a work room and an office room. This is our legacy. These are the things that we spend our time on, the things that matter in the long run for us. In our heart, there's a rec room, and this is the things that we entertain ourselves with. But also in the heart, just like so many people's homes, there is that one room, the closet, the attic, the garage, or that extra spare room that nobody else gets to go in because it's where all the junk gets thrown. This is the room with the hidden things, the things that will probably never get used again, but we can't let go. Thinking, we invited the Holy Spirit into that room. And the idea to understand that we don't have the right to just compartmentalize up our heart and say, okay, Lord, you can come in and you can come into all these rooms, but these rooms are off limits to you. Have we truly opened up our entire heart to let the Holy Spirit in? And I'll just close by saying, many of us were raised with the statement, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names and faces won't hurt me. And we've realized over time, that's a lie. Because, man, words are damaging. And sometimes we forget that when we choose words going at others. But sometimes we're very much reminded of that when the words that come at us, and we know we're supposed to shake those off, but we cannot shake them off. Many of us have had to work very hard to fix what was damaged by words. Many of us are going through still trying to let the Lord do a work and work through some of the hurt that words have done to us when we were younger or other times in our lives, whatever it might be. But for any of us who have been challenged by James's words, be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. We now have Solomon's words to help as like kind of a four-step plan to live this out. We must stay calm in the face of insult. We must think carefully before responding. We must overlook wrongs and give up our rights. And we absolutely must keep our hearts open to the Holy Spirit. I'm going to invite the team to come up and invite you to pray with me. Father, Lord, I know that you understand exactly what we feel and how we struggle even when we read something like this. To be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. And you know our battles. You know how some of us are more prone to just say the first thing on our mind and we get ourselves into trouble. You know others of us, Lord, that the processing of this and the ability to really, really listen. Lord, these are struggles, and we invite your Holy Spirit to do a work in us right at this very moment as we desire to put these things into practice. Lord, as we desire and we so badly want to be able to stay calm and to think carefully and to give up our rights, but we know that it is going to take all of your strength because we don't always have the strength on our own. We rarely have the strength on our own to do that. So would you please do a work in us, strengthen us for this, prepare us for what may come our way today, tomorrow, next week. Lord, we give you access to all the parts of our hearts. Would you move freely? Would you push out what needs to be pushed out? Lord, we want you to change us from the inside out so that we can be ready to respond in the way that you want us to respond. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Hey, thank you for walking that journey with me. And I would invite you right now, let's stand and let the worship team lead us in one closing song this morning.